Hello YouTube, this is DiskKid02 here, and this is going to be a two-part video. This is the first part of Dove Kids Presents Once Upon a Forest, performed by Ben Vern. Enjoy.
Stop and prepare to be amazed. It's really fly, said Russell. What do you think of my flapper wing-a-ma-thing? Asked Cornelius. Of course, this is just a test model. One day, I shall build it full size. Can I fly it? Asked Russell. Don't be silly, you'll crash it, said Abigail, as she dashed after the speeding wing-a-ma-thing. Almost had it, said Russell, as he leaped across the room. Furlings, please be careful, yelled Cornelius. Edgar jumped up, knocking over a tall pile of books, and yelled, I got it. But not for long. Edgar tripped over Russell and dropped the thing to the floor. A big book crashed on top of it. Great Hulk, said Cornelius. Russell said, uh-oh. I guess we wrecked the big surprise. No, said Cornelius. The big surprise is not something I made, but something I found. So let's step lively, Furlings. We can clean up this disaster later. Later, outside, Cornelius picked a flower and put it in Michelle's hair. Michelle hugged him and said,
thanks for letting me come too.
Cornelius told the Furlings, today is plot day, and we shall learn how everything we need, our food, even our medicine, grows right here in Dapplewood Forest. He tore a piece of bark from an old willow and gave it to Edgar. I can brew this to make tea to help my old aching rheumatism.
What's rheumatism?
Asked Michelle. Well, old-timers like me have stiff joints. Cornelius started to explain when Russell suddenly grabbed Edgar's hat and tossed it to Abigail.
Get it back,
shouted Edgar. Furlings, said Cornelius. We shall go home right now if you are not going to take this lesson seriously. The Furlings promised to behave, but it didn't last long. Russell couldn't wait to see the big surprise, so he dashed off down the trail. Stop! Shouted Cornelius. But Russell had run too far to hear Cornelius' warning. In fact, he had run right out of the forest and onto a road. Russell looked at the blacktop and tried to figure out what it was. He had never seen a road before. Suddenly, a car sped around the curve. It was aimed right at Russell. Terrified, Russell fell to the ground, curled up in a ball, and put his hands over his head. Cornelius and Furlings ran out of the forest just in time to see the car drive right over Russell. Edgar gasped. The driver, who never saw Russell, threw an empty bottle out of the window, and it shattered on the road. Russell opened one eye, then the other, and struggled to get up. The world is a dangerous place, Cornelius told him. You must be careful. The Furlings pumped Cornelius with questions about the car and the road. But for once, Cornelius did not have ready answers. Not now, he said as he herded everyone off the road and back to the woods. I want you to get away from this wretched place as quickly as possible. So the Furlings marched on down the trail.
How much longer before we see the big surprise?
Asked Russell. I think we're here, said Cornelius. He parted some tall grass, and there, at the edge of the stream, was a small boat. The Furlings were so excited, they all piled in at once. Both Abigail and Russell grabbed a tiller.
I get scared, said Russell.
Don't be silly, you'll sink us,
said Abigail.
Will not. Give me a check.
You two settle down, said Cornelius as he stepped into the boat. We'll all get a chance. You go first, he told Abigail and Russell. But since they didn't win, they splashed everyone with the oars.
Stop! Stop! Stop!
Cornelius shouted. Now, let's start over. Pull together. Stroke. stroke. Ah, that's so much better, he said, as they eased out into the middle of the street. Meanwhile, back on the dreaded road, a big tanker truck was barreling along until it ran over the broken bottle and blew out a front tire. The truck crashed into the guardrail, careened off the road, and landed on its side against a tree. The driver could barely open the door as he staggered out. He saw a crack in the tank and smelled something foul. Chemicals are escaping, he gasped. They're poisonous. I've got to get help. At the same time, the furnace believed the scene was not going well. Abigail lost her paddle, so she grabbed Russell's. Russell screamed, you're going to lose my paddle too.
I don't like this, said Abigail.
Gordon started to say something, but Abigail and Russell stood up and the boat tipped over. Everyone fell into the water. Swim for shore! Sitting on shore, they shook themselves dry. But Cornelius looked concerned and said, something was wrong. The woods are far too still. Even the birds are gone. We must hurry home. Cornelius and Corley stopped in shock when they reached the crest of a hill where they could look down at their meadow. All the flowers and plants were dead.
Such a hurry this morning. I didn't kiss Mama goodbye.
Russell asked. How did the poison get into our homes, Cornelius?
Humans. They've always been a threat to us. When I was a furling, humans wedged a trap into the entrance of my burrow. My father saw that there was room for me and my sister to sleep through. So we ran and hid in a hollow log until the humans went away. There was nothing we could do to rescue my mother and father. But there is something we can do to save Michelle.
What can we do?
We need to find special herbs and medicine, said Cornelius, consulting one of his big books. I write to soothe the burns on the eyes, and numbworth for damaged lungs.
But the poison has killed everything in our meadow,
said Abigail. Then you must find another meadow, and you only have 2 days' time. We must have these herbs before the moon waxes full. Or it will be too late to save Michelle.
You'll show us how to find the herb, right?
Asked Russell. I wish I could, but I can't leave poor Michelle alone. You'll need an early start, so get a good night's rest. At dawn the next morning, the furlings tiptoed to Michelle's bed. She was barely breathing. Edgar gently tucked in her covers.
We must get ready,
said Abigail.
Our time is very short.
Russell collected an armful of nuts and berries and picked up a paper from Cornelius' workbench and bundled the food into his bag.
This isn't a picnic. Pack something useful.
She tossed the Russell a book. Abigail rolled up a ball of string and put it in her pocket. Edgar took a magnifying glass. You must take my map, said Cornelius. It will guide you to the edge of Dapplewood Forest. Then, you must seek another meadow on your own. The furlings walked and walked over hills, through bramble bushes, and over slippery rocks to cross a stream. It began to grow dark, and the muscles started to lag behind the others.
Wait! Haven't we come far enough for one day? We have to keep going,
said Abigail.
Look, the moon is out. Cornelia said we have to get those plants back to Michelle before it turns far. There's a clearing ahead, but is it safe to cross?
Asked Edgar.
There's no cover. You're right. But let's run to that dead tree and then plan our next move,
Abigail said. What the furlings did not know was that the one-eyed owl was watching them from the nest in the old tree. Russell collapsed and said,
I can't run any farther with this pack on my back.
Give it to me,
said Abigail.
We can't stop here. I'm a little worried about this place, said Edgar.
Just as Russell was handing over his pack, the owl darted out of the tree, swooped across the clearing, and grabbed at me. Russell, still holding on to one side of the pack, was yanked upward with Abigail by the owl. Edgar quickly snatched Russell's tail to pull him back down, but the owl carried him away as well. The furling screamed. Abigail had to let go of the pack, and Russell and Edgar crashed back to the ground. Cried Abigail as the owl carried him towards the fence.
Take that!
Abigail shouted as she grabbed the thorn from the side of the nest and stabbed the owl's leg. The owl shrieked and dropped Abigail in his nest, where she quickly hid under some trees. Meanwhile, Russell had started up the tree to help Abigail.
We're gonna climb?
Asked Edgar. We can't dig our way up, answered Russell. The owl, furious, searched his nest for Abigail. Remembering the magnifying glass that she had taken from Edgar, Abigail held it up in front of her mouth and bared her teeth. She must have
look like a wild beast when he finally saw her. The startled owl jumped backward and knocked Abigail out of the nest with his wing. She fell into the air and landed right on top of Gregory and Russell.
Let's get out of here, said Russell. That was too close, said Edgar.
Abigail said,
thanks for coming to my rescue. Glad to help, said Edgar.
Tired furlings huddled together by the side of a log to sleep through the rest of the night. The next morning, the furlings were awakened by a group of birds who were moaning and crying as they marched beside the spot where the furlings had been sleeping. One named Phineas said,
yellow dragons have drained our nesting ground and turned it into a muddy graveyard. Now our poor Bosworth is gone forever.
If that's Bosworth, he doesn't look dead to me, said Abigail. He's just stuck up to his knees in mud.
Edgar turned to Phineas and said,
we can save Bosworth.
That would take a miracle,
said Phineas. But the furlings got an idea. They took their rope and a big stick and popped Bosworth right out of the mud. Bosworth flew up into the air and landed in his mother's arms.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! He's back! He's back! He was stuck in the mud, up to his knee. They came along and pulled and pulled and pulled, and he's back! Oh, hallelujah!
I hope you plan on staying to help us celebrate, Phineas shouted to the furlings.
I'm sorry, but we can't, said Abigail. We have to find a new meadow before nightfall.
Phineas said,
there's a glorious meadow called Oakdale just yonder. But you have to get past the yellow dragons to reach it.
Are the yellow dragons terrible? Asked Edgar.
They're huge monsters that breathe fire and smoke, said Phineas.
Edgar gasped.
Abigail said, don't worry. We can take care of ourselves.
After what you did for Bosworth, I truly believe you can, said Phineas as he pointed the way toward the meadow.
The furlings walked in that direction and found themselves in a barren, dreary place full of nothing but freshly dug holes, piles of dirt, and shattered rocks.
Did the yellow dragons do this?
Asked Russell. Before anyone could answer, the furlings were engulfed in clouds of dust, coughing, and looked up and saw the giant jaws of a snake on their heads.
Call from.
Hello?
A yellow bulldozer rumbled towards them.
How you doing?
Dropped to the ground and curled up into the
wall.
Edgar and Abigail rolled and moved up to some sewer pipes where they hid.
Love ya.
Russell's feet. They swung and pulled as hard
as they could until Russell finally squeezed through just as the steamroller smashed over the drain grate. The three furlings tumbled all the way down to the bottom of the sewer. End of side one.
Stay tuned for side two. Peace.